Well, how's this for a far-fetched storyline? A young Aussie with no previous film experience convinces the movie moguls of Hollywood that he can outdo Paul Hogan and Crocodile Dundee.
The famous pygmy fighting fish of Tasmania.
Corn flakes.
Director, writer, producer, and star. All the way from Newcastle, let's meet Mr. Yahoo Serious.
Yahoo Serious was born Greg Gomez Peed on July 27th, 1953. And for those of us around in the early 90s, well, we sure remember the guy fondly. I've been enamored with Australia ever since seeing young Einstein as a kid. To this day, actually. He definitely ranks high as far as Australian talent goes. He set his sights on the film industry and conquered his goals by acting, directing, and composing three hilarious films in his very short film career. 1988's Young Einstein, 1993's Reckless Kelly, and 2000's Mr. Accident. I can remember being a kid and being convinced that Ernest and Pee-wee were somehow related, distant cousins or something. Of course, all being based solely on the fact that they were silly adults who were there to seemingly entertain only me. I was always more of a Pee-whirl man myself, but I definitely appreciated them all. The assorted characters of film past I grouped together in some kind of unofficial supergroup. You know, kind of like how Chaplin and Buster Keaton, Marx Brothers, the Stooges, they're all kind of cut from the same silly cloth. Like I said, I had my own little group of heroes growing up that I always grouped together for whatever reasons. Pee-wee, Pee-Whirl, Mr. Bean, Drop Dead Fred, Weird Al for some reason, and of course Crocodile Dundee and Yahoo Serious. Years later, I would refer to the Dream Team as the Whack Pack in my inner monologues, as Yahoo Serious was and is part of my daily deep contemplation. And I often wonder, what happened to the dude? You know, years later, I still find myself loving his films, all three he got made in his, again, very short career. And I always thought he was the most unique of the bunch. With his films, I learned, albeit with huge grains of hilarious salt, about the life of Albert Einstein. Facts that would later make me look like a complete idiot in grade school. I then learned all about Ned Kelly, and remain fascinated by the legendary outlaw to this day. And then I learned about Mr. Accident. Yeah. But upon looking deeper into his story, I found that Yahoo was and is a unique individual. Someone who cares about history and film, and someone who had huge success and could have easily had more. But who chose to just kind of disappear instead? This is the legend of Yahoo Serious. Greg Gomez Peed knew he was going to be an artist from an early age. Being a talented musician, he probably could have thrived in that arena as well. But not even the great southern land of Australia could contain him. Well, not in any formal way, at least. As a formal education was his chosen path at first. You see, Greg Peed got into the National Art School of Australia, where, surprise, surprise, he didn't quite fit in. Often challenging the status quo and letting art just take over. He was eventually expelled for spray painting satirical jokes on the front of the campus building. But this wouldn't deter Peed, as he had fallen in love with film during school and eventually produced a documentary called Coal Town about the local town and the commerce of the surrounding area. And although it did win a few accolades, it got him nowhere. By 1980, Peed got serious. He changed his name and was known for his appearance and artistry, having aspirations to be the next Charlie Chaplin, so to speak, as he idolized the heroes of the silent film era. especially Australia's Errol Flynn. It would be his love for his land and the outdoors that would lead him to his first bright idea.
I was going down the Amazon River and a native came on board our boat to deliver some more beer, and he was wearing a t-shirt of Albert Einstein poking his tongue out, and I thought, here we go.
His first step was to produce a trailer for the film to show investors. And Yahoo Serious did what hungry filmmakers do, sell all their shit, including his car and electronics.
To start this film, there was like 20 of us all living in one house, and my mum was doing the cooking. We were all getting in a truck every day to go to location, so.
Now with the short trailer done, Serious started shopping the idea around to investors. And there was one very important clause. He stipulated to investors that he wanted complete control in return for not receiving a penny, not one penny, in box office profit, if and when the film went into production. Now, Sirius would go on to have a complicated relationship with Hollywood down the line, but he clearly had the smarts early in his career to make things happen. By 1984, Sirius had managed to get about half of the film shot with the support of the Australian Film Commission. With this, he was able to pre-sell the film to a company in the States for $2 million, which in turn gave him the funding to finish the movie. Genius! The movie started filming again late in 1985 and went on for 7 weeks. A 91-minute version of the film was entered in the 1986 AFI Awards, where composer William Motzing won Best Music. Aside from that huge landmark, the film was also a starting point of a long working relationship with partner David Roach, and a long romantic relationship with associate producer and co-star Lulu Pincus, most well known from Mad Max, who he would go on to marry shortly after production. Sirius would even do a music video with Mental as Anything to promote the soundtrack of the film, and though he has been asked about a sequel ever since this came out, he has stated his distaste for sequels in general. Quote, different is what people respond to. They go, oh good, I can go and see something new. I hate sequels because they're always done for the wrong reason. That is, they're always done for the same reason. Money. Yahoo doesn't like sequels. The film was a huge success in Australia, and Sirius was an overnight star, although the film received negative reviews in the United States, with Spin describing the release as a marketing misfire due to Warner Brothers' penchant for overkill. Roger Ebert called it a one-joke movie.
I enjoy Crocodile Dundee, including all of its Australian in-jokes, but Young Einstein doesn't seem to travel that well. Unless you're Australian, you probably won't see why it's funny that all of these things happen in Australia first, instead of someplace else. I thought the movie was pretty dull, pretty boring, and pretty disappointing for a comedy, and I give it 1 star.
While now the film is regarded to be a flop in the States, it ended its U.S. theatrical run with well over $11 million. But it can't really be understated just how huge it was in Australia. Upon release in Australia, it became the 5th biggest opening in Australian film history. It was only the 3rd film in 1988 to exceed the $1 million mark in the Australian box office. When Sirius was on the promotion trail in the United States, an interviewer would ask him if he was the new Paul Hogan. Sirius always responded by saying that Hogan was a marketing guy because he became famous for advertising cigarettes back in Australia. It was a sly dig at the rich fortunes Hogan had in the mainstream Australian film industry compared to Sirius's indie upbringing. And I, for one, was a much bigger fan of Young Einstein. It still makes me laugh till this day. When I look at Yahoo's career, what I see is an artist. The artistry really being behind the scenes, and the films a result of the melee. After the success of Young Einstein, Yahoo was an instant legend in Australia, making the cover of Time, and even the highly coveted cover of Mad Magazine. And probably the strangest thing of all, he even got his own variety show on MTV.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. David Power. Welcome, David. Welcome.
My pleasure.
Now, you're going to attempt to lift your own weight tonight.
That's right.
Have you ever done it before?
I've come close.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. David Power will attempt now to lift his own weight.
It would be then that Yahoo started to bounce around ideas for a new film, and start his plans to take over Hollywood. But it would also be then that he discovered what Hollywood actually was.
I've only got, I guess, one great Australian hero after the Tasmanian Albert Einstein, and that's Ned Kelly.
Right.
So I thought it's about time we told the true story of Ned Kelly, but I guess what we're doing to Ned Kelly is sort of what we did to Albert Einstein.
Fractured it slightly, yeah?
Well, this one's sort of like about a modern-day adventurer, bank robber, called Ned Kelly, who goes to Hollywood to rob banks, but accidentally becomes a movie star, so it's, I don't know how that's
happening. So, and you will star in it, not just write it, you'll actually star in it, or yourself?
Yeah.
It would be when trying to find funding and distribution for his next film that Sirius would find out his big Hollywood takeover would be more difficult than he ever could have imagined. The red tape mandates between the working relationship of Australia and Hollywood would prove to be taxing and rewarding. He would use a lot of his experience to his advantage, and ultimately poke fun at the industry in the film. 1993's Reckless Kelly tells the story of the modern-day Kelly gang, who kept the gang going after the legendary events of the historical outlaw, Ned Kelly. Featuring Sirius in the title role, the film tells the story of the modern-day Ned Kelly, who spends his days robbing banks in Australia to pay for the video store and alcohol production on their own private, Reckless Island, until a greedy bank owner decides to forcefully buy Reckless Island, unless they come up with the cash. Which of course causes Ned to leave for Hollywood, where he inadvertently becomes a Hollywood star. And with this, Sirius completely lampoons Hollywood.
In Hollywood, you steal the show. It's not what you do, it's who you know. The girls, the bucks, you'll have them all. When you're a star, they'll return your call. If you can just handle the fame, Ned Kelly will be a household name.
You're about to be shot dead on nationwide television.
No TV network would stoop so low.
Welcome to Newskill, live.
Sirius would have this to say about starting a working relationship with America. I kind of worry about that a little bit. We lost our film culture for 30 years because the Americans came in and bought up all the cinema chains and wouldn't show any Australian films. And these sentiments would make their way into the final film, when Reckless Island, that has been in their family for generations, is literally almost stolen out from under them. Reckless Kelly grossed over $5 million at the box office in Australia, but again didn't do very well in the States. Although it found a life on home video, it was just all too little too late, and the film was pulled from theaters after a brief and limited run. It would be 6 long years until the next serious film, but in the meantime, Yahoo kept busy. He would be spotted surfing and basically enjoying the outdoors, and he was an honorary guest at the Sydney Olympics. And Sirius is a founding member of the Kokoda Track Foundation, a humanitarian organization focused on Papua New Guinea. And all the while, being a literal living legend in his native Australia. Not that he let that affect him. At this point, Sirius had not completely disappeared from the limelight, and in 2000, his third film, Mr. Accident, was released. another collaboration with partner David Roach and wife Lulu Pincus. Yahoo had this to say in an interview shortly before production of Mr. Accident. "Now both my films have been number one at the Australian box office, and it took about 2 years just to get finance for this film. So if it's hard for me, then God help everyone else." The plot involves a very clumsy but lovable young man named Roger Crumpkin and his UFO-obsessed girlfriend Sunday Valentine, who stumble upon a plan to market eggs laced with nicotine. This would be the strangest film of the bunch. The film would get distribution through MGM and made well over $1 million in the Australian box office, being a modest success and hit with the fans, but failed to gain traction in the States once again. I think it was just an odd choice for a third film, but hey, that's Yahoo. The logical choice would have been to do another historical reimagining type movie, but Yahoo decided he wanted to instead pay homage to the legends who inspired him. You know, Buster Keaton, Charlie Chaplin, those guys. And in many ways, this film managed to do just that. And the film remains a bizarre and entertaining piece of media, released at that strange point in time known as the year 2000. Sadly for Yahoo, things would get pretty serious after that. His relationship with Lulu Pincus was deteriorating. The split would finally be official in 2007. He was devastated. Rumors persisted of an ugly divorce, and with Yahoo being disillusioned with Hollywood and Australian film industries, he kinda just disappeared. For years, fans would wonder, what happened to Yahoo? His films would begin to gain notoriety in film circles and become cult hits in their own rights, but there was no trace of Yahoo. It has been rumored that Yahoo did complete or at least start production on two more films, but due to the divorce with his wife Lulu, who was a producer, all was lost. And, you know, we might never really know if there's any truth to that. But fans would do what they could, and over the years some stories did get out. Australian fans on Reddit shared these stories. "Yahoo Sirius attended my university graduation. He got an honorary degree for services to the arts. When it came time for him to speak, the MC announced, 'Dr. Sirius will now give his address,' and there was scattered laughter through the audience. I also photographed the property which was young Einstein's farm in the film when it came up for sale. It was a running B&B, and apparently he would go back and stay there from time to time." And another Reddit fan shared this, alluding to the rumored lost films. "Well, this is interesting. He was actually seeing a friend of mine for a period of time a couple of months back, and I got to know him a bit. He's currently going through a now 10-year divorce with his ex-wife, who is trying to take his daughter and all his money, so he's not releasing the two movies he's made, so she can't get anything from them. He certainly values his privacy to an almost tinfoil hat extent, and doesn't like people looking for him or following him due to his ex-wife trying to get dirt on him. He even said something about someone following him around with a camera. And hey, presto, a few days later, a Daily Mail article comes out about him. But regardless of all that, he's really a genuine dude who is just trying to give his daughter the best life he can now. Cool fact, he still keeps his bikes from Reckless Kelly, but they're a bit too far into disrepair to get running again, unfortunately. And you know, he would be spotted around the area, his privacy basically being respected by the locals, though they all knew they were living amongst a star. But still, fans were hungry to find out why Yahoo stopped making these great movies. and why he seemed to be just done with entertainment. Film Stories magazine would have luck tracking down Yahoo's former partner, David Roach. So where is Sirius now? That is the million-dollar question. With Sirius declining in the limelight and all press interviews, I reached out to David Roach, co-writer on all three films and one of Sirius's oldest friends. Speaking from his home near Wollongong in Australia, Roach responds with a simple no when asked if he knows where Sirius is these days. The same response for a follow-up question of asking if Roach was ever told why Sirius left the film industry. A simple no. This doesn't help solve the mystery of where Sirius is, but it does appear that after Mr. Accident, he was interested in doing another film with Roach. Greg was keen to do another one, but I had had enough. I was keen to do different types of films. The very last artwork me and Yahoo Sirius collaborated on was a conceptual piece called Three People Talking About Art Until One Person Falls Asleep. It lasted 3 days. It was brilliant. No, really. Man, I'd love to see that. It wouldn't be until the 30th anniversary of Young Einstein that Yahoo would decide to grace the world with his presence and assure all of his fans he's doing just fine. The event would be hosted by The Curb and would be the first major public event that Yahoo took part of in over a decade, appearing in a snazzy suit and everything in pure Yahoo fashion, proving to be the most humble, lovable guy ever, reassuring fans that he is indeed the guy we all thought he was. The Curb would have this to say about the reunion event. There was a warmth in that room that will carry on in my soul for a long time. There was something purely religious and heavenly about the experience of that night. And while I've asked myself whether it was the wealth of beers I had beforehand or not, I've come to realize that no, it was the experience of being in the room with someone who was in charge of his own life path. Yahoo Sirius was the first Australian to write, direct, star, and produce his own feature film. And I wish that this anniversary would force Australians to reassess Yahoo Sirius and his work. We've done him wrong. We've neglected his talent and genius. And it's time we stood up and applauded and celebrated who Yahoo Sirius is. I will link the video to the 30th anniversary screening in the description. A lot can be learned from Yahoo's time in the sunshine, like how to make it in the industry, how to survive in the industry, how to leave your mark on the film landscape, and how to do it all while remaining a true artist and genuine human being. And if you are ever presented with routes in life that have no obvious destination, get serious. If you haven't seen his films, I highly recommend you do, as you will then be privy to snapshots in history when a directionless Aussie can take over the world. Oh, and also, go check out his website that is somehow still functioning. Seriously, pun intended, hours of fun. I can only hope that Yahoo returns one day and again takes over, finally getting his due for mainstream America. But then again, maybe these movies weren't made for them. Rather, maybe they were made just for us. Be sure and subscribe.
I know those words, but that sign makes no sense.
Anyway, the Down Under fad fizzled and the diplomatic climate turned absolutely frosty.
I'm here on Hollywood Boulevard, where some wacko with a trash can on his head is about to be blasted to pieces by the Hollywood Police Department. Right before your very eyes.
Okay, men, don't take any chances. Put two bullets apiece in his head, and then we'll break for donuts.